Good morning and welcome to the 31st meeting in 2015 of the Health and Sport Committee. I would ask everyone at this point, as I normally do, to switch off mobile phones, and as they can often interfere with the sound system, but also ask those in the room to note that officials and members are using tablet devices instead of hard copies of the papers. The first item on the agenda this morning is stage two consideration of the Smoking Prohibition to Children in Motor Vehicles Scotland Bill. Can I welcome the member in charge of the bill and his officials and the minister and that official, Jim Hume, MSP, member in charge of the bill. Welcome.
Morning.
Stephen Fricker, assistant clerk, non-governmental bills unit, and Louise Miller, solicitor, officer of the solicitor to the Scottish Parliament. Maureen Watt, minister for public health. Siobhan Mackay, policy executive, tobacco control team, Scottish Government. Claire McDermott, bill team manager, tobacco control team, Scottish Government. David Wilson, solicitor, Scottish Government, and Meryl Skeen, parliamentary council, Scottish Government. Welcome to you all. Everyone should have with them a copy of the bill as introduced, the marshal list of amendments that was published on Friday, and the groupings of the amendments, which sets out the amendments in order in which they will be tabled. There will be one debate on each group of amendments, and I will call the member who lodged the first amendment in that group to speak and move that amendment and speak to all other amendments in the group. Members who have not lodged amendments in the group but wish to speak should indicate to me and catch my attention in the usual way. If they have not already spoken to the group, I will invite ministers and then Jim Hume and the member of charge to contribute to the debate just before I move to winding up speech. The debate on the group will be concluded by inviting the member to move the first amendment in the group to wind up. I'll go to the amendments. I think I'm taking that most people will know the procedure rather than go through. And I call Amendment 10 in the name of Malcolm Chisholm, grouped with Amendments 11, 12, 13, 14 and 15. Can I also, at this point, draw the members' attention to the preemption information shown in all the groupings. Malcolm Chisholm to move Amendment 10 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. As it happens, Amendment 10 is the central amendment in this group, although it should be grouped specifically with Amendment 15, which defines driver, which of course is the central word in Amendment 10. My starting point for this, being a loyal committee member, is the recommendation of the Health Committee report on the bill at paragraph 65. If I can just quote a little bit of that. The committee is persuaded on balance that making the driver and the smoker liable for the offence is the sensible approach. This would bring this bill into line with other duties on drivers, for example, seatbelt legislation, be consistent with the approach south of the border, and provide added incentives to protect children from the harm of second-hand smoking in private vehicles. So I did take the view, like the committee, that having the driver liable as well as the smoker would actually strengthen the bill and the central purpose of the bill, which is protecting children from second-hand smoke. So that first amendment sets out the main thrust of all the amendments in this particular group. Amendment 11 deals with the exception subclause, which is subsection 2. So obviously new section 1A will have the same exception. Amendment 12, I'll do 14 first, because 14 deals with subsection 5, extends the 1A offence to subsection 5, which is the fine subsection. Amendment 12 extends the new 1A offence to subsection 4, which is to do with a defence in the case of section 4 in the bill, it's to do with reasonably believing that the persons in the car are all adults. Now, I understand the Cabinet Secretary is going to try and remove that subclause, which obviously complicates the debate, but certainly when I put forward the amendment, it was to make sure that the new offence applied to subsection 4. But I've also added a new defence, which is the final amendment in this group, amendment 13. And again, if I can invoke the committee report at section 67, it refers to ASH Scotland and the Scottish Coalition on Tobacco considered there should be a defence if the driver was unable to prevent another individual from smoking and the driver made all reasonable efforts to prevent the offence. They also noted this would bring Scotland into line with similar provisions in Wales, England and Northern Ireland. And you'll see the words all reasonable precautions in Amendment 13. So while the central thrust of these amendments is to include the driver as someone who would be liable in the same way as the smoker, it also provided this specific defence for the driver, which seems to me only fair and reasonable. So the amendments all hang together. I'll listen with interest to the views of the Minister and, of course, other members of the committee before deciding whether to press them to a vote. And I move Amendment 10.
Thank you. Thank you. Do any other members wish to take part in that debate on Amendment 10 and the other amendments grouped 11, 12, 13, 14, 15? No other members? Then call the Minister.
Thank you, Convener. I will speak to Amendment 10 and the other amendments in the group, welcoming the opportunity to set out the Scottish Government's position on Amendments 10, 11, 12, 13, 14 and 15 in Malcolm Chisholm's name. As it's been said, these amendments make it an offence for the driver of a car to knowingly permit another adult to smoke in the car when a child is present. I note that this was also highlighted as the preferred option in a number of submissions to the committee and discussed in the Stage 1 report with a recommendation that this change be brought forward. We therefore carefully considered the need for this offence, particularly as reference was made to existing smoke-free legislation in the Stage 1 report. Similar requirements exist in relation to workplace vehicles and public transportation in the Smoking, Health and Social Care Scotland Act 2005. I'm also keen that consistency can be achieved with existing legislation where there is a good reason to do so. That said, I'm not convinced that adding an additional offence to make the driver vicariously liable for this offence provides further protection to children from the harms of second-hand smoke. I can understand why reference has been made to existing smoke-free legislation. However, it is worthy of note that this requirement was introduced in the context of work vehicles, and therefore the offence would apply to individuals acting in a professional capacity. For example, in the instance of a passenger smoking in a taxi, it is right and proper that the driver of the taxi intervenes to prevent someone smoking. In such instances, they can rightly refuse to provide a service to the passenger in their professional capacity. This doesn't directly read across to private vehicles. The person driving is not acting in a professional capacity. Whilst I would advocate that all passengers should seek to protect children from second-hand smoke by asking others not to smoke in the vehicle with them, applying an offence to the driver could be problematic. For example, is it reasonable to hold a young driver criminally responsible for the behaviour of his or her parents if they make a choice to smoke in front of a younger sibling? There has also been reference to seatbelt legislation and the requirement for drivers to ensure that children under 14 who are passengers in their car wear a seatbelt. However, that legislation does not make it the responsibility of the driver when another adult passenger in the car commits an offence by failing to wear a seatbelt. That is effectively what such an amendment would do here. It would make an adult responsible for another adult's offence. There has also been reference to consistency with similar legislation already introduced in England and Wales. Those regulations have a number of differences from the bill introduced by Mr. Hume. For example, they do not require that the offence can only be committed by an adult over the age of 18, and so this amendment alone would not achieve consistency with the approach taken in other jurisdictions in the UK. As the committee know, the Scottish Government consulted on this policy prior to bringing forward the Health Bill. That consultation invited respondents to suggest to whom the offence should apply. 62 respondents commented on those the offence should apply to, but only 8 of those, 13%, suggested that it should be to the driver. So I think it's important that we send a clear and consistent message that all adults are responsible for their own behaviour when it comes to protecting the health of children from second-hand smoke in cars. It is my belief that the person smoking should be responsible for committing that offence. There should be no confusion or uncertainty about who is ultimately responsible for an individual adult's decision to breach the law. I note that Amendment 14 provides a statutory defence specific to the driver. Given that I do not think that the driver should be made vicariously responsible for this offence, it follows that I do not support the defence that attaches to it. However, I note that some submissions suggested that the offence should be applied to the driver in order to provide an alternative defence to the one provided in the bill. It is my view the defence provided by Amendment 14 is problematic. Applying such a defence would require consideration of what those reasonable precautions or due diligence might be in practice. For these reasons, I would ask the committee to reject Amendments 10 to 15 in Mr Chisholm's name.
Jim Hume.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to the committee, and thanks for considering this bill at stage two. I set out my views on driver liability in my letter to the committee on the 5th of October in response to its stage one report and during, of course, the stage one debate. I haven't been persuaded by the arguments presented about providing consistency with the legislation elsewhere or about being consistent with the ban in smoking places. I have four key arguments against driver liability. One is that it has the potential to distract the driver from the road, which could lead to an accident. Also, introducing driver liability unhelpfully moves the focus away from the harmful effects to children of exposure to secondhand smoke in a confined space, and then therefore strays into the realms of a traffic offence. The driver is not in the same position as the owner of licensed premises. He or she is a private individual, not running a business, and is not necessarily in a position of authority in relation to other adults in the vehicle, in the way that perhaps a bus driver is, for example, in relation to their passengers. But primarily, I believe that this just adds unnecessary complexity to a bill which is, I think, seeking to be as uncomplicated and easy to enforce as possible. Therefore, I'd thank Malcolm Chisholm for his amendments, but request that he perhaps or consider withdrawing Amendment 10 and not move the other amendments in the group.
Malcolm Chisholm to wind up, pressure withdrawal.
Okay, well, thank you to the Minister and to Jim Hume. I think Jim Hume certainly made some points there that I would want to reflect further on. In terms of what the Minister said, well, I think I need to have clarification, probably won't get it today on seatbelt legislation. Certainly the committee in making up its report thought that this would make it consistent with seatbelt legislation, but clearly that's something that I and perhaps they will look at before stage three. The Minister said that it would be problematic in terms of the driver's ability to enforce his or her will, but of course that is the reason for the defence, the statutory defence, which is it's my Amendment 13 in my list. You said 14, and that doesn't really matter, it's a detail, but one of us must be wrong. And finally, you referred to a young driver being criminally responsible, but of course the point of Amendment 15 is to make it clear that a driver means an adult, so a 17-year-old driver would not be criminally responsible under the amendments that I've put forward. But given the way in which the member responsible for the bill did put forward some substantial arguments that I would want to reflect on, I would not seek to press these amendments today, although obviously I reserve the right to do so at stage three.
Members seeking to withdraw Amendment 10. Any members object? No objection. Amendment 10 withdrawn. We now move to Call Amendment 11 in the name of Malcolm Chisholm, already debated with Amendment 10. Malcolm Chisholm to move or not move?
Not moved.
Not move. Any member object? No member object. We then move to call Amendment 1 in the name of the Minister, group with Amendments 2 and 3. Minister to move Amendment 1 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. The bill aims to exempt vehicles that are being used as a person's home. I support Jim Hume's intention to ensure that this offence does not apply in a person's home. However, I believe that the description living accommodation more closely reflects a vehicle which is being used as such. This could include vehicles such as motorhomes and caravans, but it is not limited to these examples. It is possible that other vehicles could be designed or adapted as living accommodation, such as vans with a bed, kitchen or toilet facilities. However, all of these installations may not be needed in order to consider a vehicle a person's home, and indeed there may be other installations or designs which would lead an enforcement officer to believe that a vehicle is being used as a person's home. I believe Amendments 1 and 2 are in line with Jim Hume's policy intention to exempt part motorhomes, caravans and other vehicles designed or adapted to provide living accommodation. Amendment 3 removes the test, which effectively means that a vehicle must be parked for not less than one night before it can be considered to be a person's home, and thereby exempt from the offence in Section 1(1) of the Bill. I believe that this would be problematic to enforce. For this test to be applied, enforcement officers would need to be certain as to how long the vehicle had been parked or intended to be parked. Removing this section does not change the intended policy intention to exempt vehicles being used as living accommodation. Vehicles that are parked and being used as such will be exempt from the offence. So I move Amendment 1.
Thank you, Minister. Any member wish to participate in the debate? No. Jim Hume.
Thank you, Convener. I'll keep it brief. These are straightforward amendments. They do provide a clearer definition of vehicles to be exempted. Living accommodation more accurately reflects the policy intention. The removal of subsection 3 removes any difficulty for enforcement agencies in determining what constitutes not less than one night. Therefore, I am grateful to the Minister for lodging these amendments, which I am fully supportive of and happy to support.
Minister, wish to respond? Move to the vote. Or move to the vote?
Just move to the vote, Convener.
Right, thank you. Question is then that Amendment 1 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. Call Amendment 2 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 1. Minister, to move formally.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is then that Amendment 2 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. We now call Amendment 3 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 1. Minister, to move formally.
Formally moved.
Thank you. The question is then that Amendment 3 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thanks. We now call Amendment 4 in the name of the Minister and a group on its own. Remind members that if Amendment 4 is agreed to, you cannot call Amendment 12, given the preemption I spoke about earlier. Minister to move and speak to Amendment 4.
Thank you, Convener. Amendment 4 removes the defence that the person smoking reasonably believed all other occupants of the vehicle to be adults. It is difficult to envisage what steps a person might take in order to prove that they reasonably believed all occupants to be 18 or over, beyond asking for proof of age. Even if such a step were to be applied, it would be difficult to establish that such proof had been asked for or indeed supplied. In any case, such steps would appear to me to have a disproportionate impact. I recognise that the committee in their Stage 1 report asked the Scottish Government to consider the alternative defences supplied in written evidence. I note that many of the suggestions relied upon asking the age of the child where there is any doubt. Whilst I think that this would be prudent, the same problems occur in trying to prove that this had indeed taken place. It is worth noting that many of the written evidence submissions did not believe that there should be a defence of not knowing the age of the child. There are a number of offences that exist in statute where an adult commits an offence when acting in a way that harms the health of a child, or indeed where failing to act harms the child. Reference has already been made by the committee in their consideration of the bill to the requirement for drivers to ensure that children under the age of 14 who are passengers in their car to wear a seatbelt. There is no defence attached to this in respect of whether the driver could have known the child was under the age of 14. Neither does such an offence exist in relation to the offence of a person purchasing alcohol or tobacco on behalf of a young person under the age of 18. A similar offence has been included in the Health, Tobacco, Nicotine, etc. and Care Scotland Bill currently being considered by the committee, which will make it an offence for someone over the age of 18 to purchase a nicotine vapour product on behalf of a person under the age of 18. Again, this offence provides no defence as to whether an adult could reasonably know the age of the child. I therefore see no reason why a defence of this nature should be applied to this offence. Adults must take responsibility and, if in doubt, should not smoke in a car when a person who may be under 18 is present. So I move Amendment 4.
Thank you. Any other members wish to participate in the debate? No bids. Jim Hume.
Thank you, Convener. I am content to support the Scottish Government amendment to remove the defence and grateful for their consideration again.
I presume the Minister doesn't require any time. Thank you. Then we move to the question that Amendment 4 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Thank you. We now go straight to Amendment 13. In the name of Malcolm Chisholm, already debated with Amendment 10. Malcolm Chisholm, to move or not move?
Not moved.
Not move. No other member wishing to move? Okay. We call Amendment 14 in the name of Malcolm Chisholm, already debated with Amendment 10. Malcolm Chisholm, to move or not move?
Not moved.
No other member wishing to move? Thank you. The question is then that Section 1 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. The question is that Section 2 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. Call Amendment 5 in the name of Jim Hume, grouped with Amendments 6, 7 and 8. Jim Hume, to move Amendment 5 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you very much, Convener. Before I speak to the amendments, Convener, I wish to, of course, record my thanks to the Minister and her officials for the continuing spirit of partnership, which has enabled us all to get to this point. The schedule to the bill, as introduced, allowed for the fixed penalty regime to be enforced solely by Police Scotland. But during Stage 1, it became clear that there was a wide-ranging support for a joint enforcement regime between Police Scotland and local authorities. Both the Scottish Government and I have been persuaded by this argument. Amendment 5 replaces the schedule to the bill with a new schedule, which provides for joint enforcement between Police Scotland and local authorities, thus strengthening the bill. I've worked closely with the Scottish Government to revise the schedule to make it as similar as possible to Schedule 1 to the Smoking Health and Social Care Scotland Act 2005. This will make enforcement simpler for the police and local authorities, as they are already familiar with the fixed penalty regime that applies under the 2005 Act. In particular, the new schedule provides for fixed penalties to be paid to the local authority in the area of which the offence was alleged to have been committed, or a person acting on its behalf, rather than to the Clerk of Court. Other references to the Clerk of Court in the schedule are replaced by the local authority throughout the amendment. Despite the fixed penalty regime being modelled on the 2005 Act, paragraph 4 retains the fixed penalty for an offence's £100 and allows a period of payment of 29 days with no provision for an early payment discount. I'm pleased that to date the Scottish Government accepted my position on this. And there is provision, of course, for the Scottish Ministers to amend the amount of the penalty by regulations. Amendment 6 inserts a new section to reflect the joint enforcement regime, granting entry and search powers to authorised officers of a local authority and to allow them to obtain the name and address of a person who they reasonably believe may be committing or has committed an offence under Section 1 or to have information relating to such an offence. This is based on similar powers available to local authority officers under the 2005 Act. Amendment 7 in the name of the Minister gives the Ministers various ancillary powers to make regulations, and sets out the procedures to which regulations made under the Bill will be subject. Subsection 3 reflects the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee's recommendation that regulations under paragraph 11b of the new schedule in relation to keeping off accounts be subject to the negative procedure. Amendment 8 is just a consequential amendment, and I now move Amendment 5.
Thank you. Minister, to speak to Amendment 7 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. I will speak to Amendment 7 in my name and the other amendments in the group. In the memorandum that the Scottish Government sent to the committee in March 2015, we made clear our support for Amendment 5 in Jim Hume's name. It suggested that a joint approach to enforcement between local authorities and Police Scotland could be considered in respect of the Bill. Environmental health officers have played a vital role in supporting the implementation of existing smoke-free legislation, which I'm sure we can all agree has been a success. A primary aim of the Bill is to protect the health of children by reducing their exposure to secondhand smoke. Protecting public health is fundamental to the role of environmental health officers in Scotland, and they would bring with them a wealth of experience. It makes sense that Police Scotland also has a role to play, since they have powers to stop a moving vehicle, whilst local authorities could enforce the offence in respect of stationary vehicles. However, whilst enforcement of this offence will be important, the aims of the Bill cannot be achieved by enforcement alone. This is about promoting a change in cultures and attitudes. We know that the harms caused by exposure to second-hand smoke are widely understood, and therefore the majority of adults choose not to smoke in their homes and cars when children are present. We developed our national campaign, Take It Right Outside. This aims to raise awareness of the risks posed by second-hand smoke to children. We launched that campaign last year to a positive reception. The evaluation of the campaign showed it had an impact on behaviour, but more needed to be done to drive home the message that it is never safe to smoke in enclosed spaces with children. We relaunched the campaign last month with a stronger message which takes account of the evaluation's findings. It is my belief that the introduction of this offence will provide a deterrent and continue to promote this key message. We know that there has been a significant change in behaviours and attitudes since the introduction of smoke-free legislation in 2006. Enforcement in respect of that legislation was measured, and we would anticipate the same approach to the proposals in the Bill. I am pleased that Amendment 5 provides similar powers to local authorities in respect of enforcement at the administration of fixed penalty notices to those provided in the Smoking Health and Social Care Act, Scotland Act 2005. This will allow a consistent approach, albeit with a higher level of fine and no early payment reduction. I believe that these differences reflect a higher level of complexity in enforcing the offence. Having a similar approach will help to avoid difficulties associated with operating different enforcement regimes for different smoking-related offences. The committee asked the Scottish Government to consider additional costs to local authorities associated with enforcing the provisions in the Bill. The financial memorandum accompanying the Bill calculates the likely number of fixed penalty notices to be around 200 per annum. We would not expect this to rise as a result of local authority enforcement. The Scottish Government already provides £2.5 million per year to local authorities as part of their baseline grant to enforce current smoke-free legislation. My officials have met with COSLA and Environmental Health. Those discussions have raised the potential for modest one-off additional costs associated with training, guidance and producing fixed penalty notices. So I support Amendment 6. Without powers to search and enter private vehicles, local authorities would be unable to enforce the offence effectively. It is therefore essential that such powers are provided. It is also right that those who are committing or have committed an offence and those who may have helpful information yet fail to provide local authority officers with their name and address without a reasonable excuse commit an offence. Otherwise, the legislation could be easily circumvented. Amendment 7 in my name reflects a replacement schedule inserted into the Bill by Amendment 5 in Jim Hume's name, and which provides enforcement powers to local authorities. The change in procedure from affirmative to negative for regulation making powers under paragraph 11b pertaining to the keeping, preparation and publication of fixed penalty notices accounts reflects the recommendation made by the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee. So I would ask members to support Amendment 7.
Thanks, Paterson. Then Ed Millen.
I welcome these amendments, which give clarity to the role of the local authority in enforcing the legislation, because I think everyone is agreed that enforcement is one of the key issues with the proposed legislation, and there now appears to be agreement that there should be a joint enforcement approach between Police Scotland and local authority agents. The clarity which these amendments give around enforcement and the Government's stated intention to undertake a public information activity to raise awareness of the legislation will, I hope, result in the desired change in behaviour to protect children from the effects of smoke in the enclosed space of a motor vehicle. However, we indicated at stage one that it's our intention to introduce an amendment to ensure post-legislative scrutiny of the effectiveness of the measures to prohibit smoking in motor vehicles with children present. And so Scottish Conservatives will, at stage three, be proposing a sunset clause to test the effectiveness of the legislation after it's been in place for a reasonable length of time, say 3 years. So I support Amendments 5 and 6 and also Amendments 7 and 8. Thank you.
Does the Minister wish to respond?
In terms of a sunset clause, we understand the desire to review whether children are exposure to second smoke has been reduced, and indeed the number of young people taking up smoking. That, of course, is continually monitored in relation to the figures in relation to people smoking, and in terms of our Taking It Right Outside campaign, we've monitored that since its introduction and continue to monitor it, and that's why we refine the message in the relaunch of the campaign this year. So I would argue that these measures are continually monitored in other ways.
Jim Hume.
Thank you very much, Convener. I thank Nanette Milne and the Minister for their words, of course. I personally have not been persuaded that we need a sunset clause at this stage. The evidence is clear from other countries throughout the world of the damage that secondhand smoke does to children, and that legislation has led to that change in culture that the Minister referred to. This is about promoting a change in culture. This is about protecting children from the dangers of secondhand smoke in cars in Scotland, which is well documented and scientifically based upon. We know there's 60,000 children every week in Scotland being exposed to second-hand smoke, and I believe that the amendments that we've discussed and are moving strengthen the bill to do so.
Okay, thank you. Question is that Amendment 5 be agreed to, or are we all agreed?
Yeah.
Question is that schedule be agreed to, or are we all agreed?
Yeah.
Thank you. Can I now call Amendment 6 in the name of Jim Hume, already debated with Amendments 5. Jim Hume, to move formally.
Formally moved.
Thank you. The question is then that Amendment 6 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yeah.
Thanks. Call Amendment 15 in the name of Malcolm Chisholm, already debated with Amendment 10. Malcolm Chisholm, to move or not move?
Not move.
Not move. Any other member wishing to move? No. We then move to the question that Section 3 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yeah.
Thank you. I call Amendment 7 in the name of the Minister. Already debated with Amendment 5. Minister, to move formally.
Formally moved.
Thank you. Question is that Amendment 7 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yeah.
Thank you. Question is that Section 4 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yeah.
Thank you. Now call Amendment 8 in the name of Jim Hume, already debated with Amendment 5. Jim Hume, to move formally.
Formally moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 8 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yeah.
Thank you. I now call Amendment 9 in the name of the Minister in a group on its own. Minister, to move and speak to Amendment 9.
Thank you, Convener. There can be no doubt that we all have a responsibility to protect children from tobacco smoke. That's why I relaunched the Take It Right Outside campaign last month. The campaign aims to raise awareness of the risks posed by secondhand smoke to children. However, this is as important of a new law, and I have therefore committed to run a national campaign to raise awareness of this new offence. It is vital that any campaign is aligned with the timing of the bill's commencement. This amendment will allow the Scottish ministers to commence the legislation when the campaign has been developed and launched. I've already made clear my commitment to implementing this important legislation as quickly as possible, but I reiterate that now for the avoidance of any doubt. I move Amendment 9.
Thank you. Richard Lyle.
Yes, thank you, Convener. As everyone knows, I smoke and I welcome this bill, and I am sure that it will help to reduce and hopefully reduce smoke inhalation to children. In regards to the campaign, Minister, can I ask that our campaign is much better than what I've seen of the English campaign because it does not convey the message forcefully enough?
Jim Hume to wind up. Jim Hume to speak, and then we'll go to the Minister to respond to Richard.
I'm always happy to wind up, but that's usually other people I like winding up, Convener. But no, I'm very happy to support this amendment and welcome the Minister's public commitment again today to ensure that the provisions will come into force as quickly as possible. At the time of drafting, I didn't put the commencement date in the hands of the ministers. I was not clear at that stage whether the Scottish Government would support the bill. But of course, having received this government's clear support and having worked together, of course, constructively, it's sensible to give ministers flexibility in terms of when the provisions come into force to coincide with the campaign. Thank you.
Thanks, Minister.
Thank you, Convener. In response to Richard Lyle, I have to say I've not seen the campaign that's being run in England, but I think our taking it right outside message has been very forceful. Initial results show that. I think the fact that we can show that smoke lingers for up to 7 hours in a room, it gets under doors and in windows, shows that, and the picture of the lungs, I think, are all very forceful, and I hope that the campaign we run in relation to cars will be equally effective. And I'd ask the committee to support this amendment.
Thank you. Question is then that Amendment 9 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Question is then that Section 5 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes. Yep.
Thank you. The question is that Section 6 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that the long title be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. That ends stage two consideration of the bill. Members should note that the bill will now be reprinted as amended. Parliament has not yet determined when stage three will take place, but members can, of course, now lodge stage three amendments at any time with the legislation. Members will be informed when the deadline for amendments, once that has been determined. Thank you. Thank you, Jim Hume, the Minister, and the team here this morning. We suspend briefly at this point. Thank you. We now move to our second item on the agenda, which is subordinate legislation. We have two negative instruments before us. The first instrument is General Dental Council Indemnity Arrangements, Dentists and Dental Care Professional Rules of Council 2015, SI 2015 1758. There has been no motion to annul, and the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee have not made any comments on the instrument. Do any members have any comments? Don't hear any. Can I take it therefore that the committee are agreed to make no recommendation? That's agreed, thank you. The second instrument before us is Natural Mineral Water, Spring Water and Bottled Drinking Water Scotland Amendment Regulation 2015, SSI 2015-363. Again, there has been no motion to annul at the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee, and they haven't made any comments on the instrument. Do any members have comments on the instrument? I've not got any comments. Can I take it therefore that the committee are agreed to make no recommendations? Thank you. Now, at this point, we should be going on to, but we're a bit ahead of time, but our evidence session on transplantation, authorisation of removal of organs. I would propose that. That we move on from that, take agenda item number 5, make some progress on palliative care. That means that we begin into a private session at this point. Are members agreed to that?
Yes,
thank you. Right, we'll go into private session at this point, see if we can make progress with the palliative care report. our agenda today, of course, is transplantation, authorisation, removal of organs, etc. Scotland Bill. This is our first evidence session. And before I welcome our witnesses, as members will be aware, Richard Lyle and I were in Madrid yesterday, and we met with the Spanish National Transplantation Organisation, the ONT, and transplant coordinators. And I want to extend my thanks to all of those who we met, but especially Dr. Rafael Matisans for his time and assistance with the visit. We both, I can speak on both our behalf, but say it was a very useful visit, and a summary of our discussions will be provided to the committee in due course. I also want to thank all of those members and indeed the public who attended our informal meetings with us over the last 2 weeks. The members of the committee met with transplant recipients, organ donor families and faith and belief groups over the last week or so. And discussions with members believed that those were very informative, and we are very thankful for everyone who came along to those meetings and gave their time to engage with us, especially the transplant recipients and donor families, where there were some very serious and experiences being shared. And again, a note of the meeting with transplant recipients is now available on the website, and notes of our two meetings will be available in the coming days. Before I introduce the witnesses, Richard Lyle, do you have a declaration you wish to make?
Yes, convener. I think for openness and transparency, I should declare that one of our witnesses, Jordan Linden, actually works for me.
Okay. Can I therefore go on to welcome our witnesses this morning, Dr. Sue Robertson, member of BMA Scottish Council, renal physician in Dumfries, BMA Scotland; Jordan Linden, MS, member of Scottish Youth Parliament, chair of the Scottish Youth Parliament; Lindsay Paterson, policy manager, Royal College of Physicians of Edinburgh; and Dr. James Kant, director of British Heart Foundation Scotland. And I also make the witnesses aware, and indeed welcome to the committee, Anne McTaggart, the member in charge of this bill, and Anne will have the opportunity to ask questions at the end of the session. We're not expecting any opening statements, and we'll move to our first question, which is from Malcolm Chisholm.
Thanks, convener. I wanted to home in at the beginning on the conversation between the specialist nurse or whoever is having the conversation and the relatives in terms of whether an organ should be donated, because it does seem to me that that's very much at the centre of many of the debates and disagreements about the bill. And my understanding is, in terms of the bill, that will, I think, always take place, although there's the complication of a proxy, but I won't. Others will probably ask about the proxy, but given that that's central, I noted that the BMA said what we have been arguing for is a standard opt-out model whereby if an individual has not registered an objection and those close to the patient are not aware of any unregistered objection, the organs may be used for donation, whereas the Royal College of Physicians of Edinburgh says changing the role of the family to one limited to being consulted on whether they are aware of any unregistered objection by the deceased, rather than asking for their views and consent, has the potential to be highly emotive and divisive. So I'm really interested in what, because that conversation seems to me to be central to whatever system we have. So I'm really interested in the difference between those two points of view. And obviously, if the others have got views on that, I would be interested as well.
Thank you very much for that question. I think this is one of the key issues in this debate, discussion about organ donation. We have a variety of fellows across different specialties, some of whom work in intensive care, and some of whom would be renal care physicians, liver care physicians, so all different kind of stages of the potential process in organ donation. And something that through our conversations with fellows has become apparent is that at a time when it's very stressful, when, for example, there's been a traumatic accident, something which is totally unexpected, a family who are visiting a patient potentially at the end of their life will be obviously very upset, and conversations around organ donation have to be very sensitive, and I think at a time when a family are potentially very stressed, everything's happening very quickly, that a clinician who is speaking to that family and who is caring for the patient would find it very difficult to try and go against the wishes of the family at that particularly distressing time. And I think in practice, clinicians refer to the families, will speak to families, seek their consent for organ donation at the moment. And I think that's viewed as a key part of the process.
Dr. Robertson.
Thank you. That time is a very distressing time, as we're all aware, and we also represent doctors from many different disciplines. The BMA has a slightly different approach to that situation, where we think that if the public debate has been had and the legislation has changed, then that gives the whole society an opportunity to discuss their views with their family and perhaps reminds people that they should discuss their views with their family. In that event, and in an opt-out system where somebody has the opportunity to opt out and their family would not even be approached in that situation, not only would that protect the views of somebody who wished to opt out of transplantation, of organ donation, it would also mean that if that person hadn't opted out, their family are likely to be aware of their views. If they hadn't got round to opting out, but the family were aware that they did not wish their organs donated, then the family are given the option to inform the team at that time. I think that approaching the family at this time has to be done very delicately and has to be done by somebody who has as much knowledge as possible of this situation, but that it's actually potentially easier on the family. If you approach a member of your family and say, we're not aware that this person had any objections to their organs being donated, so we, therefore, unless you know they had any objections, we would like to be able to progress this and help somebody benefit from this sad situation. And I think that the families would find that an easier conversation to have than the one that they have at present.
Mr. Linden.
I don't think that I have anything in particular to say on that. I think that's something for our medical colleagues.
Feel pressured. Dr. Kant.
Thank you. And could I just begin by apologising for the state of my voice this morning? Hey, bear with me, please. I think my colleagues described two absolutely vital scenarios, and they're perhaps not necessarily contradictory. It could be that the initial scenario is one that we may have at the beginning of this process, and over time we may move to a situation where it does become much more of an ongoing narrative within families, within society. I think what we have at the moment are a cadre of specialist nurses who have the absolute clinical and interpersonal skills to be able to have these conversations. I think any system we move towards must absolutely protect that particularly vital bond and relationship they have with families, but enable them to have that conversation. And I think it's quite telling when we look at international comparisons. The countries that are doing this best are the ones where there is an absolute priority on these conversations being had within emergency departments whenever there is a scenario where death is going to be certain, and to really make that much more part and parcel of the way in which families and patients are engaged with.
That was all very helpful. Now, obviously, what we're trying to do is to, well, I imagine most of us are trying to, probably all of us are trying to do, is to reduce the family refusal rate, because that would obviously provide more organs. And British Heart Foundation say there is a yawning gap between the wishes of Scots and the follow-through to action, not helped by nearly a 50% family refusal rate. Now, what I'd be interested in, do we have any breakdown in terms of the different, well, let's say the percentage of refusal when someone is on the register or the percentage of the refusal when someone's not on the register?
I don't have that information to hand, but I will get it, if possible, and get it to the committee.
I think that's quite an important point, because I imagine everyone shares the objective of trying to reduce the refusal rate, get more organs for donation, and, well, there might be some people who have ethical objections, I suppose, to, but a lot of people will take a pragmatic view, so that it's really interesting just to know. I mean, I would kind of guess, you would assume that there would be a lower refusal rate for those on the register than those not, but it would be interesting to know that. So anyway, that's all I've got to ask.
Does anyone else wish to respond to Malcolm's question? Or is there no figures here? There isn't any. Rhoda, Nanette, is it on the same theme or a different question? Rhoda, you wanted to ask a supplementary one.
Yeah. I wanted to ask about, to my mind, it changes the nature of the conversation that is being had at a time when someone is a potential donor to asking for permission, so the ownership of the person's body passes on to their family, to asking for information from the family about the person's wishes, so the ownership remains with the person who is going to be the donor. And obviously, if the person has opted out, their family can't then opt them in. At the moment, it's very difficult to opt out, and that decision is left. So the nature of the whole possession of that body and those donor organs has changed by the bill. But that then raises the question of, what if a family were very much against organ donation? Do you foresee a situation where a family being asked if they knew about their loved one's wishes said no, but I object for religious reasons or whatever reasons, I object to that this happening? And I can't foresee a situation where a clinician would then go against a family's wishes if that was going to cause them real distress, as opposed to having a different conversation if you take it that bit further.
Yes, Dr. Robertson.
I think that's a very good point you make, and I think certainly that the BMA in Scotland are very clear that if the person involved in that conversation felt that it would cause dreadful distress to the family to go ahead, then there should still be an allowance for them to not donate in that situation. When we're looking after patients, we're also looking after their families, and we're very aware of that in that situation. And there are some situations that we feel would cause the family undue distress, and in that situation, we feel the legislation should allow us not to go forward.
Thank you.
Anyone else?
I think I'd just offer a comment on how we can avoid that situation in the first place. And I think it comes down to avoiding the misunderstandings and having those conversations in the first place. James spoke about how that will change the discussion that we're having, and how families and those involved can have that discussion. I think that perhaps might touch on one of the questions later on, or the potential for a discussion on the campaign that will be launched, because when people have the information that they need, they can perhaps address it and discuss it further, that allow them to kind of to erode some of that potential.
What within the current legislation prevents that discussion from taking place, and how will this legislation ensure there's more discussions?
Well, I think from a young person's point of view, we'd be keen to see that any move would have publications or a campaign that was young person friendly, that actually engaged with young people, and the information they could access was one which young people felt that they associated themselves with.
Why would we need legislation to run an information campaign?
I meant on the new proposal. If that was to happen, that would
require legislation. But I mean, it's good to have discussion. It's good to raise awareness. What we're looking at here is whether the current legislation needs to be strengthened, and why we said. And the question was, what prevents those discussions taking place now within the current legislation, and how would more discussions and more organ donors result in a change in the legislation? Dr. Robertson.
I think there's no doubt about it that more information, more discussion is always welcomed in organ donation, because the more people are stimulated to talk with their families about what their wishes are in the sad event of their death, the better. So that should be going on anyway, and we would encourage that continues to go on and, if anything, becomes stronger. But at the same time, we also think that a move to an opt-out system would mean a move for society eventually so that organ donation becomes the norm rather than the exception. And we think within that move, there would be more organs available to transplant into patients who need them.
Yeah, okay, we can come back to that, where the evidence across the world that the opt-out system has increased organ donation or not. But at this point, the current legislation and whether we need legislation to have a campaign or an information campaign. But Lindsay Paterson, you wish to...
Yes, I mean, I think the college's view is very much that public education, public awareness are key components that need to be taken forward. And that's aside from legislation, that families should be having conversations about potential organ donation. And it means at a time when perhaps an unexpected accident has happened, something very tragic, then that people are aware at that point, at a very stressful time, they know that they've had these discussions with their family members. And I think that awareness raising among the public is vital to that.
We've mentioned accidents a couple of times, and you know, where do the majority of our organ donations come from now? Is it accidents?
No. I don't have the statistics to hand, but we could easily get them. They're a mixture of reasons for sudden death. So you have accidents being one, but for example, cerebral hemorrhage. So that's a brain hemorrhage.
What's the average age of a donor?
Do you have the number? Again, that's a number I don't have, and it would depend whether you're talking about what organ you're talking about for donation as well.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I've got a number of others who wish. Nanette?
I wanted to have a little bit of clarification around the issue of appointment of proxies. When we met with the donor families, there seemed to be a feeling coming from them that they were concerned that this would actually complicate the system and could possibly delay the organ donation to the extent that perhaps organs which would have been useful are no longer. So that was one point. I've also heard it said that the fact that this is in the bill really is because it's in the Welsh bill and may not be necessary at all. So I just wondered what the views of the witnesses are and if you could clarify that for me.
Thank you. I suppose I look on it as a role similar to an executor. I think in some ways we perhaps have looked towards the Welsh example for some guidance there. I recognise the concerns you raise about having a system that is sufficiently timely and is not overly bureaucratic, that actually doesn't encumber the process. I think what we have to do is strike a balance between clinical need and protection that would be applicable and relevant for particular sections in society who may have been estranged from their families. I think that would be something that would actually require some careful consideration and balancing as we moved forward with this. I think the Scottish Youth Parliament got some important insights that they can offer as well in terms of exactly particular groups in society for whom this would be perhaps more important than for the rest of us.
Thanks very much, James. So the Scottish Youth Parliament are supportive of the appointment of a proxy. That comes from the research that we did with young people, the survey, where 10% agreed a little and 70% completely agreed with the proposal to appoint a proxy. And that was based on the fact that people are in diverse situations, and it's our belief that proxy gives more options to individuals and young people aged 16 or over, more freedom to choose what happens to their body after death. And if you don't mind me sharing, I've got a direct quote from a young person in the focus group who said, young people should be given options. They would know best who should help make the final decision after their death, and it would be their decision to choose a proxy or not. And we felt that the option to appoint a proxy for those aged 16 to 18 is in line with Article 12 of the UNCRC that allows the views and wishes of a young person to be respected and taken into account. And James spoke about particular groups. We believe that the option to appoint a proxy is especially necessary for those aged 16 to 18 who are in care and may not feel comfortable for their nearest relative or legal guardian to make the final decision about what happens to their body after their death. And that's a belief that's shared with the Centre of Excellence for Looked After Children in Scotland. So that's kind of the Scottish Youth Parliament's position on that.
The British Medical Association don't object to the idea of proxy for exactly the reasons that you've just given. There are situations that we think it would be a very worthwhile thing, but we are mindful that we should try and keep the system as simple as possible, as you said, and it does bring a complexity to the situation that isn't there otherwise. I think that part of the bill is certainly something that merits further discussion. But I think there is a place for a proxy in certain situations, but it has to be that this can be done in a timely fashion for clinical need. It would be nice if there was a system that was similar to that in the other UK countries, because we have a UK transplant population. But I think for Scotland as a whole, it certainly... it needs to be simple, as well as having the safeguards that you described. So it's a difficult one. Thanks.
The issue of proxies is something that our fellows had quite mixed views on, but certainly a number of reservations. One was about the time element. If an individual is able to appoint up to three proxies, the time taken to contact the proxies, and I suppose the reliability of the database as well, that the proxy information would be kept on, that would always need to be kept up to date. And also in terms of the potential conflict between if a proxy had differing views to the views of the immediate family who were at the patient's bedside. So some reservations over those aspects.
I mean, it's my understanding that proxy details would have to be provided either on the register or pre-exist in writing and be signed by the deceased person, obviously, beforehand. That's why I really just wonder how it would work and how do you think the system of appointing proxies should actually work?
Anyone? Yes?
Just a brief comment in terms of, I noted that the proposed legislation the kind of policy memorandum perhaps said that proxies would need to be informed beforehand or give consent to the fact that they were going to be listed as a proxy. So it may be that somebody's unaware, and I think that would also add to the time problem, which doesn't fully address your question, but it's just an extra element of that I think should be taken into consideration.
Okay.
Sorry, could I just wonder?
Yeah, yes, certainly.
Just whether you think that in the proposed system, a soft opt-out system, that really proxies are necessary, or would the system work quite well without?
I think that if the campaign is done well and the public education is excellent, as it should be for any change in legislation such as this that is proposed, then you would hope that proxy might not be required, because the overarching aim here is to find out the wishes of that individual in the event of their death. And so you would hope that with time that would not be needed, but it might be a safeguard that people would feel is important for certain groups, such as the younger members or people disaffected with their families.
Just on this campaign, again, I've got to be up on it. I mean, I think we all accept, campaign, that's good, we're going to raise awareness. Also, and some of the evidence we've taken from people who are very successful, we've got double our rates of donation. Campaigns are divisive. They split doctors and communities, they split others, and they don't always equal a better outcome. Have you looked at any evidence about the public campaign, education and awareness, and found from that evidence that there's a sustainable benefit for donation, increased donation?
I think what you probably won't find at any point here is anybody suggesting that soft opt-out will be the magic bullet to cure this problem. I suspect that what you will have seen in Spain and what we've seen through international comparators is that it has to form part of a far wider campaign. It has to form part of a far wider emphasis on multidisciplinary and interlinked services. And it's only when we have that working together that we can really hope to actually increase the number of organs that we have made available and actually been facilitated for transplant use. What my research colleagues in BHF in London have not been able to find much evidence of, or evidence at all, is a situation where there's been a significant increase in transplant rates that hasn't actually featured soft opt-out as a component of it. Now, I accept there's a mixed evidence base there, but our organisation's belief is that soft opt-out has to form an important part of a multifaceted approach that we would have to take.
The Spanish soft opt-out is final reference to the family. Family object, doesn't go ahead.
And I think that goes back to the conversation you had earlier with Dr. Robertson, but I think perhaps what moving the legal framework does is it subtly changes the implication. The de facto framework changes, and I think that probably has a very significant long-term effect on the type of conversations and the societal expectations that go with it. But I think you're absolutely right to point out the fact that, and I think Dr. Robertson also was very keen to point this out as well, which is that we are dealing with people and families at the most distressed time in their lives, and that compassion has to come through whatever system we have.
Bob Doris.
Thanks, convener. I'm going to pursue the role of the proxy a little bit more. Then I want to come back onto that conversation that takes place currently and how legislation would or wouldn't change that. And I think those two things could actually be linked. Question that came into my head in relation to a proxy was one over any time delays that might be built into the system, which would be an unintended consequence, but a negative to passing a bill where proxy was part of that. Does anyone have any concern in relation to how easy it would be to locate a proxy, for example, because the proxy is only there to give that informed view if they can be located? So has any thought been given to that, and how long should we wait until we do that?
Anyone?
I think it's very difficult to be specific on that. We sometimes have to try and locate families in these situations because they happen without any warning, as Lindsay was saying, and sometimes it's very difficult to locate families in that situation too. So with the way our society lives, we don't live necessarily in the same place as our families do, and we may actually find it easier to locate a proxy for that person if there's somebody who is particularly close to them, if they're estranged from their family. So, yes, the proxy issue is a concern because of the time delay, but then locating a family can often involve delay too.
Okay, anyone else on that point?
Yeah, I think I would refer you back to my previous answer to the Net Mill, which is that anything that would undermine or prevent a timely process is something we would have to very seriously consider. This has to be a practical system, and I think, as Jordan indicated earlier, there are particular groups within society for whom a proxy may be perhaps more important than others, and it may be that we could consider that as a particular element of it in terms of, say, for example, looked after children. But what we're looking to do here is establish a system which gets the correct balance between respecting individuals' wishes, but at the same time having a more efficient transplant system. So anything that would in any way jeopardise the timeliness would be something that, you know, obviously we'd have to look at.
Paterson?
Just really reiterating a number of the points that Dr. Robertson made. I mean, time is of the essence when making decisions about organ donation, and often decisions have to be made in a number of hours. Contacting families, contacting proxies, there's, I suppose, no guarantee you're able to get hold of anyone in that time frame. But in terms of my concern would be trying to contact a number of different proxies and ensuring that a database was kept up to date. There's no guarantee that there would be details of a family to hand either, but it is a concern just because of the such a tight time constraint, trying to get in touch and get a hold of proxies in that time.
That's very helpful. You raised the point about making sure any database of proxies is kept up to date, and also how in some circumstances it might be easier or not to locate the proxy as opposed to the family member. So I suppose I would ask, should we not be trying to locate the proxy and the next of kin? Would there not be a duty to do both of those things? So could that build in delay perhaps? And in relation to proxies and the idea of that act of choice, should proxies stay valid? So if I was to nominate a proxy today, in 15 years' time, had I not bothered to change that, would that still be a valid thing to do? Should proxies only be there for 1 year, 2 years, 5 years? So I'd appreciate some views of that. And I'll put a third one in, so I hope you're taking notes. I'm keen to get your views on evidence in relation to this. What would happen if the proxy and the family member had quite strong disagreements over what the individual wanted? And that's maybe will come in for my next question in relation to that conversation with transplant coordinators and families or proxies. So I know there's a lot there, but I'd really appreciate you being able to put some of that on the record in terms of the time delay and whether proxies should stay there infinitum or for 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, and where conflicts might arise.
If I could take a couple of those points, I think the point you make in terms of potentially time limiting a proxy would seem eminently sensible. And in terms of the question of contacting both, I think in an ideal world, that may be what people would look to do. But I suppose thinking about it from practical terms, and again going back to the example given previously in terms of looked after children, one of the reasons that people may opt for a proxy may be because in the event of their death, they may not want both proxy and family to be contacted, which again would be something that would have to be factored in and respected. But I think you're right to highlight the complexities of developing a system that has efficiency and equity within it and has that timely fashion too.
Anyone else?
I think that the first two points, Bob, are for my colleagues, but on the conflict question, in terms of sharing the views of the young people that we spoke to, so a significant number of participants agreed that the role of the family should be limited. 20% said that they agreed a little, and 60% said they agreed completely. That was one of the highest levels of agreement in the survey. So I think that in constructing my argument, it's to say that we fully should be aware of the difficulty, and I think that James put it quite eloquently, you know, the compassion that we have to have as human beings, but also to recognise the kind of the time that the family members are going through. But the point that the Scottish Youth Parliament are trying to make is that the young people who we spoke to expressed the need for a young person's decision to be final on that. And again, if you don't mind me sharing, a young person said it should always be the decision of the deceased person rather than that of the family. And I think that that kind of comes down to the conflict thing for us, is that young people's voices and views should be, you know, the final on that.
Anyone else? Yes, Dr. Robertson.
I think most of it's been said already. I think ideally getting in touch with the proxy and the next of kin would be the ideal, and I think we would hope that that would be done if at all possible. I think that even with a family, when we have a whole family that come in the event of someone's illness or the event of them dying, then the families don't necessarily agree. So there's always potential for disagreement. And that is one of the things that the specialty nurses in organ donation are trained to deal with, to try and help the family come to some agreement about a way forward that they think that individual would want in the event of their death. And we go back to this being about the person who has died's wishes as to what would happen with their body in the event of their death.
Maybe you had a different question around the proxy.
So proxy and next of kin, ideally we would want both to be contacted. Time is difficult, and you know, we contact families often, and we get a mobile phone that is on an answering machine. So having a proxy in doesn't take that away. There is potential for disagreement always, even just with a family, and we have to mitigate against that, and we have to deal with that in the situation, and that's what we're trained to do. How long should you be a proxy? Yes, good point. I hadn't thought of that, but I agree that there probably should be a time limited proxy, but I couldn't tell you what the right length of time would be.
Lindsay Paterson.
I think some very interesting points have been made here. I think in terms of the time on the database, there probably should be a time limit, just to ensure that the people listed there is the correct details and people you would actually still want to be contacted. However, in terms of should you know, family members be contacted at the same time as proxy, I think we would say yes, because our fellows still have a strong view that the family should be involved in this process. And I think that if there was potential conflict between the views of the proxy and family at the bedside, I mean, I appreciate at the moment that family members may have different views. Where a proxy had perhaps this a legal position where they were able to put forward a view, I think that that may cause distress to a family where they were, you know, placed in a legal sense and able to put forward a view. I think some of our fellows are concerned that the conflict there may undermine confidence in the medical teams where there was a legal obligation to follow the views of a proxy, for example, over the family members.
Okay, now I know some of my colleagues, our convener's telling us wanted to come in relation to the proxy as well, but I had said at the start of my questioning that I wanted to link this to that conversation that takes place when there's the possibility of having suitable organs for donation in relation to this. Now, I wonder if you could tell me what you think the views are of transplant coordinators or the specialist nurses or the doctors who are having those conversations when the situation happens. In terms of, at the moment, my understanding, I could be wrong, we've still to take evidence from that particular group. The sensitive conversation is very much, if they don't carry an organ donor card as well, if they didn't carry an organ donor card, would be really keen to use those organs to help, you know, a variety of other individuals who could really benefit from that. Flipping the whole thing around would be, you know, this individual has not indicated an opt-out and would be keen to use those organs. I'm just wondering how very different the conversation would actually be in practice if this legislation came through. Might it actually be very similar, but could an unintended consequence be an added layer of complexity during those conversations that the organ coordinators or the nurse specialists may or may not feel is appropriate or otherwise? So do you know what those on the ground that are having those conversations, so not specifically the BMA, for example, but doctors on the ground that are having those conversations, or nurse specialists on the ground that are having those conversations, have they raised any concerns in relation to this, and is there a way to mitigate against that?
Anyone? Yes, Dr. Robertson.
I think if you... I'm a kidney doctor, so I work with patients who are waiting for transplants. Uh-huh. And so I don't have the conversation with any potential organ donors in my hospital because I'm looking after the patient who may or may not benefit from those organs. But I think that in these situations, the specialists who are involved in the organ donor programme are very, very mindful that they don't wish to cause distress to the family. They're very well trained to try and alleviate the stresses involved in that conversation. And I think that the conversation that might be had in the event of a change to an opt-out system would be not that different, but the nuance of it is easier. I think it makes it easier for the family. And so it may be easier to approach that family in that situation if organ donation becomes more of a normal thing to do rather than an exceptional thing to do.
Do you mind if I ask, have you been told...
Have we got any other responses?
My apologies, convener. Yes,
no absolutely. Other responses on that initial question from Bob? Mm-hmm. No? Okay then, Bob.
And my apologies, other witnesses, for not giving you that opportunity and just coming straight in with a small supplementary. I'm just wondering, Dr. Robertson, do you intuitively think that, based on you working with those who are awaiting organ transplants, or... is that what you think, based on conversations you've had with the actual people on the ground that have to speak to those that have lost loved ones? I'm just wondering where you form that view from. That would be quite helpful.
I have spoken to other doctors. I haven't spoken to our transplant coordinator or our organ donation specialist nurse about it. I've spoken to other doctors because people have heard that I speak on behalf of the BMA on organ donation, and other doctors have asked me about the opt-out. Potential opt-out legislation. And in our discussions, I have described what the new legislation would require. And I have had no other doctor that has come back to me in that discussion and said, that's going to make it a more difficult conversation to have. And in fact, they have said, that sounds like it would be an easier conversation to have, but I haven't spoken to the specialist nurses in organ donation.
But are we actually saying that we've identified one of our senior hospitals, someone who's on life support, would be a good candidate for organ donation. And because this law is not in place, because that person doesn't carry a card, that there's no discussion between the medical team, the transplant team. That discussion doesn't take place right now. Is that what we're saying? Yes, Lindsay.
I'm not a clinician, but my understanding is the conversation would take place. The family would be asked, had the individual opted in, or if they hadn't made any views known, then the family would be asked if organ donation would be a possibility. So my understanding is that conversation would take place around that.
So it's just a question about whether the legislation, and I think Dr. Kant's issue about changing maybe a general attitude towards us and raising an expectation that conversation would take place is a good point, but whether the legislation. The other point, just on time, and relates to some of my earlier questions, that a minority of our transplants are likely not to be road accidents anymore. They are older people and they're on life support. So I just make that point. Now, why wouldn't it be possible in those circumstances to contact a proxy or confirm that person's point of view, that be a minority of cases where the time limiting factor would be in place. So I'm just wondering, there's been a lot of a lot of presumption that the proxy might delay the process, but given that lots of transplants the person will be on life support, that it's not something that needs to be done in half an hour or 2 hours. Or I'm just trying to put it into context. That, is that the case? Is it really time limit? You know, is a criticism of a proxy vote a strong argument because it's time limiting, or just the complexity or friction between the proxy and the family? Yes.
I think in the situation you describe, where a patient is on life support and may have, for example, a life-threatening brain hemorrhage, that their brain may be dying, but their body is being kept alive, you do then have more time. But what we would like to see is, in all situations where there's a potential for organ donation, that can be allowed to happen. And some of those situations, there will be much less time. So there'll be a section where there is time, and there'll be a section where there isn't time. So yes,
but it doesn't apply right across the board.
It's
possible in many instances
that
to have the time,
yes,
to reach the proxy, yes, to deal with the family in an appropriate way and spend time with them.
And this is not something that anybody will rush.
Yes, of course. I've still got some questions on proxy from Mike and Rhoda.
Thank you, convener. I'm just wondering if I can get a bit of clarification on the need for a proxy. And just in my thinking about it, you know, if I make the assumption that the bill passes and there's a public information campaign and people then think to themselves, you know, perhaps for the first time, you know, I now need to do something about this as a potential donor. So they either have the thought that I'm not at all comfortable being a donor, and they opt out. And, you know, that necessitates an active choice. The do nothing option is the assumption is made that you'll be a donor. And then we have this third option to appoint a proxy. And that again implies an active choice. You have to name and go through some process to name a proxy. But it occurs to me that the only scenario that's likely to take place in is that if I wanted to be considered as a donor, but I thought there would be opposition from my family, and I want to ensure against my family blocking my wish, so I appoint a proxy. And I just wonder, first of all, I would ask, you know, am I correct in my analysis? And secondly, is there perhaps a bit of a danger in looking at the Welsh situation and suggestion of a proxy rather than just a further degree of opt-in? In other words, if I wish to put the matter beyond doubt, why has there been no consideration that I can have a positive opt-in, carry a donor card, and put the matter beyond discussion and doubt, and perhaps prevent all kinds of unnecessary and difficult discussions?
Yeah, that was a supplementary, and I'm going to take Rhoda's supplementary as well, and you can deal with both at the same time, please, on proxy.
Mine is not unlike that, because I believe if someone has opted out, we've already established they don't need a proxy because that wish is taken into account, so there's no need. One imagines if they've opted in, neither do they need a proxy because they have made their own views known and that is recorded. So it seems to me the time when a proxy is needed is when you're not on the register, which just doesn't work because you wouldn't have a proxy. And I'm wondering if that could be dealt with better by encouraging people who were estranged from their next of kin to have a power of attorney, that would make that decision and indeed make other decisions? And are we maybe missing the opportunity here to say to people, if your next of kin is not expressing your wishes or not around, you need to actually make provision on a much grander scale for what happens when you're not able to make those decisions, and allow the register to speak for itself and the next of kin to speak when the register is silent?
Any responses? Dr. Kant.
Yeah, I think these are both very, very good points. You know, I said initially to Nanette Milne that I see this role as being akin to an executor or power of attorney. So you're suggesting that you actually go down the formal and established power of attorney road, I think is potentially a very, very sensible one. And I suppose what the other thing that was mentioned was almost a virtual proxy. So instead of registering and affirming your wishes with an individual person so that they couldn't be overturned by family or relatives, then what you would be doing is you'd actually perhaps be doing it within a system, per se. So I think both of these are very, very, very valid suggestions and could perhaps offer an important practical way through this.
Anyone else? Nobody? Is there anybody, go back to the campaign again, has anybody got any concerns at all that a debate around this bill that focuses on proxy would actually damage the level of organ donation? I mean, I just recall this morning it was led on radio that this proxy, it wasn't about the altruism of donation, it was about the division of the of overriding family wishes. Now, does anybody have any concern at all that if the debate around this issue and this organ donation could actually harm and reduce organ donation? Dr. Kant.
Yes, is the short and simple answer. Anything which removes the focus of what we have as our ultimate aim has got to be a concern. And I think looking at this from a political and from a media point of view, this is a very juicy element of what is always a difficult and contentious issue. I think coming back to what Dr. Robertson said earlier, there is already often a significant amount of existing conflict within families at this very, very difficult time. Having a situation with a proxy would add a new agent, but wouldn't add a new dynamic per se. The dynamic of conflict is already in existence in many cases. I think the proxy element is an important fail-safe. Again, going back to some of the people that Jordan mentioned earlier, there are certain elements within the community that we owe it to them to be ensuring they have an appropriate fail-safe to make sure that they're views can be respected. Now, whether that would be in a virtual sense by explicitly registering their wishes or whether it be through a proxy, I think is open to debate. But yeah, I would very much share that concern that proxy became too much of the focus of this particular issue.
Is that a concern that's shared by the panel or not?
Yes.
I think we've already seen that this morning, as you mentioned. On the radio, and I think, as we said, the BMA are concerned about making this more complex than it needs to be, a simple message.
Yeah, there's no dissent. The very patient Dennis Roberts.
Thank you very much, and good morning. Really, I want to explore a wee bit of what Dr. Robertson was saying earlier about family and the potential of conflict, even within a family, at this very difficult time. Because although the family may have some agreement with reference to organs, there may be some disagreement with reference to tissue. And I'm really referring to eyes and cornea. And, you know, we've been focusing very much on the organ donation, but we haven't really explored the tissue. And I'm just wondering if this is a difficult conversation that families do disagree with sometimes, because they're maybe saying yes to organs but no to tissue, or you know, maybe vice versa sometimes. And I'm just wondering, do we have any figures at the moment that suggest that organs themselves are more likely to be donated but fewer people are signing up to, for instance, cornea donation.
Anyone? I don't have those figures. I could try and find them out for you, but I don't have them to hand. I'm not sure whether they're available, but we could try and find them out.
I think one of the reasons I'm asking is when we were having a discussion with families, families were saying, and one in particular said, yeah, well, absolutely no problem with organs, but never my eyes. But later, and it was a sort of hindsight after they'd met someone else, they had changed their mind. And it was just this, you know, I just wonder if there is any evidence, and I'm just wondering maybe if Dr. Kant through BHF have maybe got that type of evidence.
I think you raise a very, very important and telling point there, because if you look at the figures, we have such strong support for the principle of donation when we ask people in the calm of the here and now. What we have when we have the trauma of death is a situation where that calm reasoning inevitably comes under attack through emotion. And I think what you refer to there in terms of people differentiating between organs and tissues is a perfect example of where calm, rational thinking perhaps succumbs to emotion. And I suppose, again, this is one of the things that I think lends itself towards the notion of soft opt-out, because it perhaps changes the framework of conversation and thinking to move it back towards that slightly more calm and rational discussion that people will have in the here and now, where they will express their support. If you think about the kind of scenario that families are faced with at that time, there is no worse time to try to have them seek to engage in this kind of conversation. And I suppose what we're looking to do is perhaps take some of that trauma and emotive element out of it by moving the debate slightly further back.
Anyone else? Dennis?
Yeah, I'm just wondering if it's legislation that is required, or if we need to adopt another system by where, say, someone actually goes into hospital, and we all, you know, anyone that's been in hospital will have gone through a tick list. Inevitable tick list, I'll tell you. But whether or not one of the questions in that tick list should be, you know, whilst you're here, if any, circumstances, you know, I mean, obviously, that the death occurred, maybe at that time, you know, someone going in, it doesn't matter if it's for a minor procedure or not. I mean, things can go wrong periodically, and they do. But I'm just wondering, should we maybe routinely, if someone is actually going into hospital, have that question asked? Therefore, you know, that requires you've updated a register, you've got that person's either consent or not, at the time they've been maybe admitted into hospital. Should that be routinely maybe something that could be asked? So the conversation's there.
Dr. Kant, then Dr. Robertson.
Yes, I think that would absolutely be the way forward. Whether we move towards a soft opt-out or not, I think what you described there would certainly encourage conversation on a family basis, on a societal basis. And if we did move towards soft opt-out, I think that would actually be a very, very important way of affirming the move. I remember the first time I went to the States as a 19-year-old and saw one of my friend's driving licenses over there and asked what that simple dot meant. And that dot on that Colorado driving license indicated that they were a confirmed donor. And it was so much part and parcel. I think what we need to be doing is looking at it in an all-encompassing fashion, trying to provoke and promote this conversation with people at every opportunity. I think you're absolutely correct. You know, whether it be in terms of secondary care or whether it be a visit to the GP, I think it's a conversation we absolutely want to have, so that we're actually touching on people from as many different access points and avenues as possible.
Dr. Robertson.
I perhaps have a slightly different spin on this. As somebody who admits people to hospital as emergencies every week, most people who come into hospital not for, perhaps even for elective surgery, are quite frightened at that point. And they're frightened of the unknown, or they're frightened that they might die, or they're frightened that something terrible will happen to them. And I think that that would have to be a very, very carefully managed conversation if you were asking people at a very frightened and vulnerable time. What we want to do is ask people when they're not frightened, when they're not feeling vulnerable, when they're at their best. So, for example, the visit to the GP, or, you know, when you're getting your driving license, or, you know, one of those times when you feel well and you feel at your most robust is the time that that discussion should be had. And I think, I don't think that our society might be ready for that discussion on entrance to hospital yet. Maybe in the future we might be, but I think probably not yet. But that's a personal view, that's not a BMA.
No one else? Dennis?
Yeah, with reference to our younger people, at the moment, a young person at the age of 12 can opt to have a donor card. But with the legislation that's being proposed at the moment, you know, it's perhaps they can still go for the donor card, but their wishes at the moment within this legislation wouldn't be absolutely upheld, would they?
Well, I can offer comment on the 12 to 15 year olds in terms of what young people said to us, and that was that the option should still remain for them to choose to opt in. That was 85% of the young people that we spoke to said that between 12 to 15, the option should still remain for them to be able to opt into that process if they choose. But again, the majority believed that 16 was an appropriate age to be considered an adult for the purposes of organ donation.
Okay. So would you be supporting, with the soft out option, the you can still opt in at all occasions, at any time, on a register?
In terms of 12 to 15-year-olds, as I say, the young people that we consulted with said quite clearly 85% that they think that the option should remain for them to be able to opt in between 12 to 15.
I think I'm looking at all age groups still being able to opt in, or does that complicate things?
I don't fully understand your question, Mr.
Robertson. I'm saying basically should the opt-in still be available at all times, even if we go down the soft out option here, that people can still register to opt in, basically still carry a donor card, because they want to have that sort of facility to try and ensure that their wishes are going to be adhered to. So people may still carry a donor card, or could be on a driving license or whatever, as Dr. Kant suggested, the Colorado method. I'm just wondering, do we need more than one system?
Sorry, I understand now. In terms of the questions that we asked, that wasn't a question that we asked young people, but I think speaking from a young person's perspective, I certainly think that that would be a very helpful idea to have a dot or such on my driver's licence. I wouldn't be opposed to that as a young person myself. I think that's actually quite a good suggestion.
Dr. Kant.
Okay, speaking as a former young person, I actually think it's something that's really quite special and significant about our system just now, where we do allow really young people to make an affirmative statement on what they would like and what their wishes would be. I think it's empowering, and I think it enables our young people from a very, very young age to demonstrate something about, you know, what they see as being their role and potential in society, even in the event of their death. So I would be loath to see that lost in any new system.
Good, thank you.
Dr. Robertson.
I think it also helps the parents in that situation too, because parents will say to you when they've lost a child that they knew that their child wished to donate their organs, and so they followed on their wishes, even though they found it really hard to do at the time. And I certainly haven't spoken to any parent who regrets that, and they hold that very dear in that situation.
It draws us again, though, to the importance of, to when the conversation takes place, doesn't it? Because, 94 Scots, according to the British Heart Foundation, say they support the principle of donation, yet only 41% of them register. And if everybody who's registered went on to donate, that doesn't happen either. So I suppose even when you are a confirmed donor, this is what we are discussing here, where you know, how do we ensure that those confirmed donors are able to express their wishes through donation. I wonder how much of that would increase the donations that we have and the organs that we have available. And to what extent organ donation reflects refusal by the family? Or is it more important that doctors, clinicians are identifying donors right at the start of this process would give us more donors at the end of the day rather than any of these other measures? Dr. Robertson.
I think there is no doubt about it that we're getting better at identifying donors, but we're still losing some potential organs for transplantation because donors have not been identified. And we're working on that, and that work needs to continue. No matter what happens with the legislation, that work to improve the donation rate from suitable organ donors needs to continue. So I don't think it's an either or, but we still think that in order to try and improve the donation rates further, the soft opt-out system would add more organs for donation.
But you can't tell me how many more, how many do we lose through family refusal? And we've spoken quite a bit about family refusal in that discussion. How many do we lose as compared to the focus on what organs are available? How are we identifying those organs? How are we ensuring that we can get those organs used? I mean, I'm just trying to get, it's a focus here about Dr. Kant.
I'm afraid I can't give you an exact or even a general figure as to how much of an increase we could have. What's concerning is the rate of family refusal. I mean, the figures I have for 2014-15 was that 46% of families refused donation because they didn't know what the relatives' wishes were. And what's also concerning is that during 2014-15, we saw a 7.7% decrease in family authorisation. So the conversations are not taking place, and the rate of family refusal is actually on the increase at this point in time. And it goes back to the point I made earlier. I think the single most important thing that this legislation could do would be to change the framework, to have the default position that there would be an assumption that people had opted into the system, because otherwise we're relying upon conversations which aren't taking place currently, or conversations which do take place in the calm of the here and now, but which then don't translate into actions when we actually have the death of the person themselves.
I'm not understanding this, because, you know, we have got confirmed donations. You've just told us that people who have expressed a wish, the family refusal rate, you know, could be up to, what, 46%? So, you know, that family refusals are, what was the figure?
No, what I said was that family refusal, it said that 46% refused organ donation because they weren't aware of their relatives' wishes.
But there's only one conversation. Ultimately, even if they expressed a wish, they signed a donor's card, they had a discussion, we spoke about proxies and all of that. The important discussion is not around, you know, the dinner table some Saturday night, whatever, if people have these conversations. The conversation is at that point in a clinical situation, at the point of death, irrespective of whether that person's expressed a donation, signed a donor's card or expressed a wish in the past, we've all conceded that the family will make the decision at that point. So how does this legislation change all of that? How does it get us more organs?
For me, it changes the dynamic of the conversation, it changes the dynamic of the system, and it changes the expectation within Scottish society. It will not, on its own, be something that solves the problem here. It's something that has to take place on a multifaceted basis. It has to have a significant amount of public information that goes with it. I think the fact that the legislation exists at all will in itself provoke significant amount of public discussion.
And controversy, as we've conceded, which could reduce organ. I mean, you know, we are all in this room wishing to see an increased level of organ donation. We're just trying to examine whether the legislative process is the way to do it, if the family refusal rates are the problem, or whether it's a conversation that takes place, or indeed, if practice was changed to identify as soon as possible in the system those potential donors and support that organisationally to ensure increased organs were available for organ donation. It's just a focus where, you know, what would give us greatest benefit.
I think the one thing we can absolutely guarantee that what will increase will be controversy, because this is such an emotive subject. It will always generate significant passion on both sides. In terms of the BHF evidence and policy position, on the balance of what we've seen in terms of international studies, it's our position that what we require is a multifaceted approach, and soft opt-out is an integral part of that.
Okay, well, I think I've got three bids, and then we're going to, given time, we're going to wrap up at that, haven't we? Bob, and then Dennis has one another quick question. Okay. Rhoda, is there anyone else? Thank you.
A couple of questions. I'll maybe just stick with one at the moment. If there's time at the end, I'll ask the other one, because my colleagues also want. And it's also worth saying that this feels a little bit like a poison chalice. I didn't catch radio this morning where there was a focus on proxy rather than the commitment we all have to increasing more organs to save lives or to improve the quality of lives. But the reality is this committee has got the duty to thoroughly scrutinise robustly every aspect of this piece of legislation, or we've been doing our job properly. But so that feels a little bit like a poison chalice in doing that. So I wasn't obsessing about proxy, neither am I obsessing about authorised investigating persons, but I am about to ask questions on it because that's my job as a committee member, so it's worth pointing that out. So it'd be interesting your view to know about who the authorised investigating person should be, because there might be a little lack of clarity in the bill in relation to who that person should be. It would appear that it wouldn't necessarily be the nurse specialist or the medic on the ground who would be having that conversation, but they would have a duty and obligation in law, if this bill was passed, to seek to identify and locate the proxy, if one existed, to seek and identify the next of kin, and to make sure all due process had been followed in an appropriate manner. So whilst not all organ donations are time sensitive, you'll appreciate again why I'd ask about whether that or not that could lead to undue delays. I suppose it would be reasonable to ask whether or not, as soon as you put something in a legal framework like this as well, whether there's a potential that people take a precautionary principle. So for whatever reason, if there was a lack of clarity during that process that the authorised investigating persons were going through, that they would say, no, don't take these organs. And could that be an unintended consequence? I'm not saying it will be, but these are concerns that have been raised. So I'm just wondering, in relation to where, who the authorised investigating persons should be, what their role should be, whether that would be burdensome, or whether putting it in a legal framework could create some unintended consequences.
Any response? Dr. Khan, we're testing your vote to destruction, your voice to destruction here.
You certainly are. I can give you a limited response. In terms of BHF, we see specialist nurses as playing an absolutely vital role in this. I think you make an incredibly important point in terms of the balance between ensuring that anybody who's designated to fulfil this role feels legally and morally protected, but at the same time, we have an efficient and timely process. That's a balance I don't think will be easy to achieve, but is absolutely vital. As an organisation, we would actually look to NHS Scotland and colleagues working there for their expertise in how best to move this forward. We think they would be best placed to advise on this.
Okay. Lindsay Paterson.
I think that Dr. Kant's raised some important points there, because at the moment we don't know specifically who would be responsible in this regard, because that will be set out in regulations. However, much of the role was outlined, particularly the kind of investigative tasks currently fall to the specialist nurse in organ donation. I suppose where queries would come up are in terms of is this additional burden, essentially, a legal responsibility, what kind of additional pressures or would be involved with becoming the authorised investigating person, particularly in terms of the legal authorisation. I think that's where there may be some queries from that aspect.
Dr. Robertson.
Whilst we could see, the BMA could see a clear advantage of having people in this role, it would need to be something that would be very carefully thought through. You'd need to work out how many people you needed in these roles. Some of the roles are those of the specialist nurse in organ donation, and the obvious people to do some of these roles would be those specialist nurses. But to have an overarching legal requirement, it may be something that they are not at present fully skilled and appropriately trained to do. But they would be the obvious people initially on the ground. You would have to make sure that whoever was doing this job, there was availability at any moment in any day of the week. And that would need to be properly resourced, and they'd need to be properly trained. So it is an extra requirement that will require resource. Yes.
What does the transplant team do and this? Do they not do that? I mean, I can see a role for the specialist nurses, but I also see there's a clinical role to establish a point of death, whatever. There might be the fiscal in a young death, there might be in a violent death, there might be all sorts of which would require a doctor rather than a nurse. I can see the softer role for communication, but I'm just wondering what the transplant team do in all of this. That separation from the, as you described, the doctor who's trying to save the life, at some point that's no longer viable. Somebody needs to come in and assess whether those organs are viable, the potential of that donor, there might be legal requirements, you need to be aware of that. Who does that now?
At present, the transplant team do that.
Yeah.
As described, it sounds as if there's a possibility of somebody who then makes a decision that the transplant team have done their job appropriately. Now, I'm not sure whether that I've got the meaning of that slightly wrong. But the transplant team are regulated. We're all covered by our, for example, the General Medical Council or the General Nursing Council regulations. Mm-hmm. And so we all work within a legal framework. And the transplant team are very careful to have due process because they know that this is such a difficult issue.
Right.
And whether you would need somebody extra as well as the transplant team, or whether you could designate the transplant team member as this person, that certainly might be a possibility, I think.
Okay. I've got another couple of, who have I got in my list? It's Dennis, firstly, Rhoda, and then... supplementary that one, okay, yep.
Right. What I was going to ask, is there a need for such a post, given that, okay, this is new legislation, but the common law already exists, so if there was an issue about the legality now, it would be tested through the courts under the common law. And I'm wondering if this post is required, because the donor team would surely be looking at all those aspects as part of their day-to-day work.
I see nods in agreement there. Yes, Dr. Robertson.
As I said in my answer to Mr. Torres, I think that the transplant team do this job anyway. And I don't know if you need another person, another layer. But I'm not a lawyer.
Okay, dokie. Dennis.
Thank you, convener. we've already heard a few times today that the conversation is a very difficult one, and we know that there are team specialist nurses, donor coordinators. Are we aware how many families say that they are prepared or they accept the fact that donations are there because a loved one has expressed that wish? But during the conversation with the specialist nurse or coordinator, when specific questions are being asked, which are extremely sensitive, are we aware of how many people walk away from that and say, no, I've changed my mind? Because it gets into the realms of extremely personal and difficult questions. And is it a situation that we need to try and ensure that that type of question, because you're probably aware of them, that people should be made aware of that at a much earlier stage when people actually sign up, so there's information out there? Because it does hit people like a brick wall when you're asked these questions by the coordinator just after a loved one has died, whether it be a child or parent or sibling or whatever.
Dr. Kant.
I think it's a really important point you make there, Mr. Robertson. I don't know that such statistics exist. I think given the nature, it would be something that would be difficult to assess, but I think the dynamic you describe absolutely exists. And I think in many cases it can be a practical barrier to the process of gaining parental agreement. I think the questions would be intrusive for many parents at any point in time, but given the particular traumatic situation they find themselves in, that must just accentuate.
Yeah, I mean, not just parents, but any loved one or whatever. I mean, it could be a husband, wife, whatever.
Yeah,
It's quite intrusive, and I'm just saying, do you think people should be made aware that these are the type of questions that could be asked before they make decisions?
I think, yes, I agree.
Okay, thank you. We've got an area which we haven't covered. Could you cover that, Bob, in terms of incapacity?
Yeah, we're just trying to make sure we cover the full range of issues with the bill, and there are issues in relation to adults with incapacity. So it would appear, from the way the bill's currently drafted, that it would prevent a welfare attorney from either appointing or withdrawing the appointment of a proxy or objecting to the removal of adult organs. And a few submissions have raised concerns with that. I think the General Medical Council and the Scottish Government have raised concerns that effectively the individual, obviously the adult with incapacity, could not opt out, but also their appointed guardian would not have a legal basis for objecting to this also. And I'm just wondering, in terms of getting the balance of rights correct in relation to any soft opt-out system, if this would turn for a certain group of vulnerable people, if this could make it it's not an opt-out system at all, and others are locked into that process, and if that's something that you've given consideration to.
Nope. But that's okay.
That's fine. Yeah.
That's okay. It's just, you know, we'll have an opportunity to ask others. But Mr. Linden.
A brief comment, convener, would be that I think that the caveat for us, thinking about vulnerable young people who may have, you know, learning difficulties, disabilities, comes back to information again. If this legislation was to continue, it's absolutely essential that appropriate materials and an appropriate campaign with information is there to allow young people who are vulnerable to make an empowered and informed decision. I think that's the only thing that I can say on that, that we've that was certainly the message that young people shared with us in the survey.
I think the committee members now have completed their questioning. I invite Anne McTaggart, MSP, member for the bill, to ask some questions now.
Well, thank you, convener, and thank you, members of the committee. I've got a few wee points. Convener, is that okay? Can I just race through them?
You've got 3 minutes.
As long as that. Obviously, from the outset, the Scottish Government and I share the same ambition. Obviously, that's to increase more donors, more transplants, and obviously to save more lives. someone had raised a question earlier about, is this bill necessary? Is this legislation necessary? Absolutely, yes, it is necessary. Otherwise, we wouldn't. I most certainly wouldn't be sitting here putting myself through this and putting others through this. We do need to increase transplantation. It's not worked to date. Whatever we're doing is not working. The Scottish Government's Transplantation Plan 2020, we have fully backed that. The government have done so well in trying to increase the transplantation. However, as I'm sure it was Dr. Kant had mentioned, it's fell by almost 7.5% last year, and that makes Scotland the worst performing in the UK. Now, I'm not happy with that figure, and neither would many around this table. The deceased donor transplants in Scotland also fell by 13% last year. But the most worrying figure is the first quarter figures for this year show that we are heading for an even bigger decrease in deceased donor rates of 10%. Convener, what more do I say? And I've got loads more to say. But anyway, international evidence, I know. International evidence has proven, you mentioned earlier, or someone had mentioned earlier about, is this necessary? Is this bill necessary? How do we know it's going to work? We know it's going to work because what's been done to date hasn't worked. And what will be done is we have looked at international evidence and they have seen an increase between 25 and 30%. Now, we don't have to circle all around the world. We have used the basis of the Welsh Government's bill that's going to go in operation as of the 1st of December, as people will be well aware. They have also used the international evidence. We have to do something different. Whatever we're doing just now is not working. International evidence shows us that 25 to 30% increase will happen if we move to a soft opt system. Anyway, it's that 3 minutes. You've still got me.
Yes, that was for the introductory remarks, but you need to get to some questions now.
I will. Also, just really in the evidence that you have taken as well, the 856... They have given it yes. 85.28% of them believe that the bill will lead to an increase. And some of the other questions, I know, I will get round to you. The new pressures on the SNODs. Could I ask again, the panel members, the NHSBT have written evidence and have specifically said, can I explicitly ask for the panel members to explain what the SNODs currently do and what the NHSBT currently do?
Okay. Can we have any response to that question? Oh.
No.
Can you inform me what a snod?
A senior. Sorry, convener. That's entirely my fault. I'm up to here and back with the organ donation bill. It's a senior nurse of organ donation, and the CLODs is a clinical lead in organ donation. Sorry, that's right. My apologies.
I can't give you the full details of what the specialist nurse in organ donation does. But they are an integral part of the transplant team at every stage. And they will, a referring unit will refer to them directly, and then they will come to that unit and they will coordinate everything from there on. So they're a very highly skilled group who have a lot of different skills to your standard nurse. They're very good at speaking to relatives, and that's why that relative refusal rate is so disappointing, and I'm sure to them incredibly disappointing. But they do a huge amount behind the scenes, just making everything happen as it should happen and in as timely a fashion. And if you wanted to know more about what they did, we could either interview one of them for you, or we could get them to write their job description so you know exactly what they do. They have an integral part at every level.
We'll be taking some evidence on and around that anyway. Is there any other responses to that initial question?
Controversy was mentioned earlier. Can I ask the panel members, and in particular the Scottish Youth Parliament member, controversy? We've had bills go through here before, and can I ask, should we shy away from something that we think just now is controversial? And can you think of any other bill or legislation that people may well have thought of as controversial at the time, but now have changed their mind, and it's as a good thing that it's now changed?
Thanks very much for your question, Anne. It's a nice non-technical question, and snods and clods and all the various acronyms. I think there's two things in that, two bills that I, two pieces of legislation that may have been perceived to be controversial, both of which I'm proud to say that the Scottish Youth Parliament grabbed and campaigned on. One would be the Equal Marriage campaign, when we launched our Love Equally campaign just over the back at the Scottish Parliament, calling for the consultation to come quicker. In fact, the consultation came much quicker, and then obviously we have legislation, and then obviously votes at 16 as well. Mm-hmm. Obviously this Parliament unanimously voted for votes at 16, but it still remains an issue that we're continuing to fight the cause for at Westminster as well, so that we can see young people casting their vote in all elections. So that's two pieces of legislation. On the more general point of campaigning on issues that are controversial, as somebody who chairs the Scottish Youth Parliament, who doesn't shy away from controversial subjects, I'd say absolutely not. If it's controversial, then I think it's important to ask why it's controversial. And if it's because it causes conversation, then I think that's a wholly good thing. And I think it's conversation, as colleagues on the panel have said already, conversations are just the starting point to making a difference here in Scotland on that issue.
Yes, Anne.
Thanks, Convener. And another one of my questions that I've been taking notes from, and I can hardly read them now, so you'll have to bear with me, a different type of conversation. The culture, the time, there was a lot of time spent on the proxies. Can I just say at this point, Convener, this bill is not the Anne McTaggart bill. It will be the Scottish Parliament's bill, and it will be for every member of this Scottish Parliament to be part of that. And it is open for conversation, just like we talk about conversations around families and through the issue of organ donation. This will be a conversation, and I think everyone should have a right to discuss what's within this bill to make it the best bill ever possible for people. We do have the time limiting for the proxies somebody had mentioned earlier. Can I ask, and it was Dr. Robertson, I'm sure, what evidence from the doctors, can you reiterate some of the evidence that you've had from doctors, what the difference may well be if they are going to have a conversation with a member that you definitely know does, and it actually secures their place on the register if they've definitely opted out, that wouldn't be happening. Or, you know, what is the conversations and how is that felt for the doctors whenever they do go to speak to families if their relative or the deceased one is on the register or off the register? Can you expand on that?
Excuse me. Well, at the moment, the way the register works is you can register to give your organs in the event of your death. But as we know, although 9 in 10 people say they would wish to do that, only 4 in 10 have their names on the register for many different reasons. So there's a big gap there in people who would like to give their organs but haven't registered. The advantage of the opt-out system is that if you don't want to give your organs, you register that and your family aren't even approached. So the people who don't wish to give their organs have their views respected in the event of their death. And then we approach the family in a slightly different, it's a different nuance, to ask whether they were aware of any objections that hadn't been registered. So I think that it makes it a less difficult conversation to have with that family in the event in that very stressful time. And I think that it's more likely to allow you to respect the wishes of that person who has died.
Okay.
Thank you, Convener. And really that's ultimately what we all want from this bill. is for it to be an easier process for the families of the deceased persons, and obviously to enable more organs to be donated.
Okay, that concludes this evidence session. Thank you all for your attendance and evidence, both oral and written. Thank you very much indeed. We're going to suspend at this point. We've got a very, very short private session.